Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the third annual ALA Symposium. I want to once again apologize. Tea and coffee is on the way. I know that many of us like to start our mornings with a nice hot cup of coffee or tea, and other refreshments are forthcoming. So once again, if you can bear with us, as you know, there are a number of activities taking place on campus this week for in honor of AUC Research Week. So please bear with us as we await the arrival of our refreshments. Once again, good morning and welcome to our third annual ALA Symposium. I'm Doris Jones, the chair of our OTIS and ALA Publicity Committee. Our theme for this year is Collaboration for Student Success. This theme was chosen since it clearly addresses one of the most critical issues facing higher education today, which is how to provide access to and sustain instructional practices that will enable our students to fulfill their post-secondary aspirations. That is quite a tall order when we consider the number of students that we interact with from the beginning of the fall semester throughout the spring. So it's quite a responsibility, and the word collaboration certainly fits well with what we are attempting to do as the Academy of Liberal Arts. So, a liberal arts education, therefore, provides the intellectual scaffolding for students to learn how to learn in order to be successful in a variety of capacities. Yet, more can be done to enhance the liberal arts in our academic programs by integrating learning into our students' complete undergraduate experience. This initiative challenges the prevailing model of higher education by asking further, how can the ALA and the larger AUC community actively integrate and embed the liberal arts into undergraduate education across all of the disciplines? And we're so very proud that our keynote speaker has been at the forefront of bringing these types of initiatives and ongoing discussions to the AUC community. So our symposium stands as a testament to the Academy of Liberal Arts' commitment to bring together our learning communities, consisting respectively of the Department of Rhetoric and Composition, the Department of English Language Instruction, and the Department of Arabic Language Instruction. We are each committed to increasing student learning and to build cohesion within the AUC community. As learning communities grow, we recognize the need to invest in faculty development and understand faculty experiences. That means today's presentations represents our faculty's ongoing commitment for lifelong learning, that they have received, in many cases, teaching enhancement grants, conference grants, research grants, a number of support faculty grants to allow them to continue their practices in order to bring our practices to the classroom. So, with that said, we are proud that today we will have 12 presentations from our faculty, and they represent, once again, a variety of their teaching experiences and the impact that they're having on their pedagogy and ongoing research. With that said, please join me in welcoming our Dean of Undergraduate Studies and the Academy of Liberal Arts, Dr. Robert Switzer.
Well, thank you very, very much. It is a pleasure to be here. It is a pleasure to be celebrating with you all what I kind of think of as a bit of a birthday party for the Academy of Liberal Arts. The annual symposium for me represents that. It was 4 years ago, in 2013, that we were launched at a lunch. The Academy of Liberal Arts was born and announced in April, 4 years ago. And to mark our first birthday, many of you will remember, we had a retreat and a special awards dinner, and in 2014, and since then, 15, 16, and now in 17, in April, we have sort of marked our birthday with the ALA Symposium, which has become a very successful tradition. And I think as a four-year-old, the ALA is now fully a toddler with a mind of its own, and the unpredictability of any four-year-old, but also the incredible energy and enthusiasm that marks that age. And it is an exciting thing, like with the child, to watch the ALA grow up and mature and take on a life that is increasingly visible and with an a really tangible impact on this university. More and more, I would say, taking its place at the center of what this university is about. We ask ourselves, what is the ALA? We asked that question 4 years ago, and we ask it perennially and rightly. The Academy of Liberal Arts is many things, right? It, along with the Office of the Dean of Undergraduate Studies, it is the home of the core curriculum, which again is absolutely central to what defines AUC as an American-style liberal arts institution of higher learning in Egypt and in this region. In particular, of course, the freshman program, which is the foundational aspect of the core. In addition to the core, we have responsibility more broadly for students transitioning into AUC. So the freshman program is a big part of that, but of course it begins, the students first encounter the advising center, which is with us, and the students encounter the, many of them go through the bridge programs in the ELI. I think my phone is telling me something. Apologies for that. You don't have to switch off your phones, but I should at least switch off mine. So we have a lot of different roles, as it were, in providing foundations for our students. And that's sort of definitive of what we do. But it's more than that. We also have the incredible Office of Undergraduate Research with the incredible Amani Alshimi, who just handed me this incredible book that collects together the amazing things that are happening in AUC Research Week. And Amani, as I think all of you know, has taken a leadership role in this entire extravaganza, if I may, of all of the things that are happening this week, including, of course, the Eureka Conference, which is undergraduate research, FIRE, which is a wonderful program. Today, the ELI students will be presenting all of these things. And I think we're very proud that at the center of this, on Tuesday, today, is the ALA Symposium, a very key part of this incredible week of activities. And also, the Academy of Liberal Arts is one of the sponsors of the AUC Research Conference. So we have our fingerprints all over this. And I wanted to thank Amani in particular for the incredible work that she's done to make all this happen. There's a lot to talk about. I mean, I need to mention ACE and academic community engagement, another aspect of what we do. But what ALA is ultimately is the faculty that make it up, the 100 or so incredible faculty that it's been my privilege to work with. And these faculty that are charged with foundational courses in English and in Arabic and in introducing students, in writing, of course, in critical thinking, in RET, and overall in introducing students to the life of the mind and to successful communication across cultures. And as I said, we're more and more at the heart of what AUC does. You may have seen the video that was done for the inauguration where they look back at all of the different presidents. And I was touched and proud to see that when they got to the period that has just ended, the last 5 years, they talked about Lisa Anderson, and during that period, the launch of the Academy of Liberal Arts, and I'm quoting, to enhance the independent thinking skills of undergraduate students. And that's a nice way of putting the essence of the Academy of Liberal Arts, to enhance the independent thinking skills of undergraduate students. When you look at the recent results of the survey that was done about AUC's priorities, the number one, you know, winner, most popular thing that we should be focusing on is fostering excellence in teaching and learning through innovative approaches and practices. And of course, that was followed closely by advancing excellence in research through discovery, inspiration, and impact. The Academy of Liberal Arts Symposium is about both of those things. We are focused, as the university is focused, first and foremost on teaching, and we, in many ways, I'm proud to say, the Academy faculty are leaders, and they are inspirational to the rest of the faculty in excellence in teaching and innovation in pedagogy and curriculum development and teaching styles and so on. Also, the faculty, despite not really that being a focus, have an incredible record in terms of research and professional development, publications, and an incredible range of activities in that regard. And bringing these things together is exactly what the symposium tries to do. If you look at the Academy of Liberal Arts overall, the commitment that unites the faculty and programs is the support of student achievement. We really do, I think, put the student at the center. From the bridge programs in ELI through the RET, core, and seminar courses at the heart of the freshman program, and the upper division classes in RET and the Arabic language instruction courses that reach out to an incredible range of students, from diplomats and CASA students and so on, at various levels. ALA fosters teaching and learning that is engaged, relevant, and above all, student-centered. So this third ALA symposium will bring together faculty work in a range of disciplines and from a variety of perspectives, dedicated to enhancing the classroom experience and ensuring student success. And when you look at the program, and I won't, you know, rehearse everything, but, well, actually, I think I am going to mention just about everybody, but sort of putting them together. So, for example, Iman Solomon is going to introduce us to CASA Without Borders, while Elizabeth Yoder will show us how AEG programs offer research and writing support in the School of Science and Engineering. There are going to be several discussions of innovative teaching approaches. Amani Demian and Yasmin Salah Al-Din in ELI will discuss using WhatsApp. Hossam Atia and Rhett will talk about using Google Plus, and Leila Al-Sawi in ALI about using ads in teaching. Rania Jaber is going to switch the focus to the students themselves as test creators and how assessment can be a process of learning for students. Afaf Mishriki and Amani Demian from ELI will discuss how annotation can be a tool for better reading and writing. Hanan Hassanein will discuss the issue of dyslexia in teaching Arabic. And Mariah Fairley and Suzanne Rizzo have two papers, including one on engaging students in academic discourse synthesis. And near the end of the day, there are two papers that I think are a little more theoretical, coming from ALI. The chair of ALI, Dalal Abu Al-Sud, will be speaking on pedagogical implications of language variation, and Mona Hassan will present an experimental sociolinguistic study on language change. To start things off, and I can only echo what Doris said, we have in describing his work, we have an excellent, we have the excellent and incomparable Ahmed Tolba, who will be giving our keynote. I want to briefly thank three people that have worked very hard to make this happen. There's a lot more, and I should also mention Marwa and Noha in the office that have done so much. But the committee that has been at the heart of this is made up of Mariah Fairley from ELI and Heba Fethal-Bab, and has been chaired by the incomparable Doris Jones. And I never tire of thanking Doris. There's this symposium wouldn't have happened 3 years ago without Doris's efforts, and it has been sustained, and it is thriving. And Doris and your committee, I want to just thank you very, very much for all the work that you do. It's really tremendous. And with that, I will bring my own comments to a close. I just want to thank all of you for being here. I want to thank the people who have contributed their time and energy to making and preparing their presentations, and those of us who get to enjoy them. We're looking forward to a great day. And happy birthday, ALA.
Thank you, Dean Switzer. So without further ado, since we have such a busy day of activities planned ahead, I just want to make my own personal comment about our keynote speaker, Dr. Ahmed Tolba, before he comes up to the podium to deliver the keynote address. I must say, it has and it continues to be Dr. Tolba who has sensitized me to the aspect of integrative learning, the aspect of a term that he introduced me to more than 3 years ago, which is removing ourselves from academic silos. I became very excited about that phraseology, removing ourselves from academic silos, and what exactly does that mean? And when we begin to look at what is occurring in the arena of higher education, what are the statements that are being made that is transforming and continuing to sustain the significance and overwhelming importance of higher education? It is more than ever that we need to connect all of our disciplines. We need to find language, critical language, if you will, to be able to allow our students to see how their learning connects from one course to the next, not only from their freshman year, throughout their sophomore, junior, senior, graduate, postgraduate, and of course their professional and personal lives. So I'm so very thrilled that Dr. Tolba is able to come and share and celebrate our third annual symposium with our theme, Collaboration for Student Success. So Dr. Tolba, as we know, is currently the Associate Provost for Strategic Enrollment and Management. He's also an Associate Professor of Marketing here at AUC. He was awarded his PhD from George Washington University in 2006, his MBA and Bachelor's of Science, respectively from AUC in 1997 and 2001. His research focuses on brand equity, innovation marketing, online marketing, nation branding, social marketing, and entrepreneurship. He has published in leading academic journals and at conferences. He also co-authored the leading textbook, Principles of Marketing, Arab World Edition, and Marketing Gurus with Philip Kotler and Gary Armstrong. I can go on and on about Dr. Talba's many outstanding accomplishments. So without further ado, let's please welcome our keynote speaker, Dr. Ahmed Talba.
Thank you very much for coming, and it's a great pleasure and honor to be here, and I think there is a major exaggeration in what Doris was saying. It's just like too much. I'm very flattered. Well, I think it's a great pleasure to be here because I am simply a firm believer in what ALA is doing. I'm a firm believer in liberal arts education. I am an AUCN since 1992. When I joined, so I've been there for as an undergraduate, as a graduate, and now 10.5 years as a faculty member, and now I'm also taking an administrative role. So it's really my second home, and I'm very, very proud to be here. The second is that I'm also very proud to be discussing this specific topic, which is related to student success, because this is my passion. People who know me know that I'm a big passion for teaching, for talking to students, for mentoring students, for working with them. So, like many of you, and some here have attended the life mentoring program that we have initiated, and we have seen very, very positive energy up there. So, I'm a big believer that collaboration is going to be the key, because we have a lot of people who are extremely excited to make a difference on campus, and student success is our objective, but sometimes the collaboration is what is missing, and that's what I'm going to focus on today. The word silos, yes, I was the one who revealed this term to Dr. Jones a couple of years ago, but actually I got it from the literature and from the talks. It's not my term, of course, so I'm going to prove that right now today. I'm going to have today a mix between the concept that I think is important and all of us know, but just like a nice integration for it, and also a brief about how this is applied in my area, so that also we have an application. Whether this area is the business or school of business area where I work and do research on, and my administrative area in strategic enrollment management. So I'm going to integrate the three together in this quick session. So as Dr. Jones mentioned, is like I have a background from AUC, graduate from AUC twice, but let me show you the degrees that I had. First is I had a Bachelor of Science in Construction Engineering, and then I had corporate experience at Procter & Gamble in finance, and then I had a Master in Business Administration, and then a PhD in Marketing, and now I teach Marketing at AUC. So it's a diverse kind of background, and I learned from each one of them. And I love each one of them, by the way, and I can see the linkages. And this is one of the things that were critical to my life, is that when I was asked the question when I graduated with highest honors from construction engineering, why are you changing your field? And for me, why are you losing 5 years of your life? And I thought, I answered, why do you want me to lose the rest of my life? So that's what the question. It's not that I don't like, I love it, I love the field, but I found passion through internships and through finding the skill that I have, understanding the skill that I have, and also understanding what other fields are. And when I understood that, it was easy for me to pick the places where I can excel and find the best in my skills. And that's the key. And this is the story of my life, is I always look at what I'm good at and what is there, not just where I am and what degree do I have. It doesn't work this way. And it's not that I was not liking my field, I loved my field. If I return back, honestly, I will go back to the same field. But I don't believe that science is outside the area of liberal arts. I think it's all about how it's taught. And that's how my thoughts are about liberal education in general. I don't believe in that liberal education is about the courses you take, the name of the course, It's about the breadth that you have. It's about the critical thinking that you apply on the courses. It's about what you acquire as skill and how well-rounded you are. So I don't believe that we should label this as, because this will in itself be a silo, right? So if you say that this is the humanities, so you are in this area, this is the science in this area, no, it does not work this way. As a former science student, once I got exposed to the core curriculum, which was one of the most important changing agents or changing elements in my life, and I thank ALA and all these and AUC for that. It really changed my mind because I found different areas. I found the breadth that I was looking for, and this really made a difference to me. I also took a minor. I got exposed to most of the activities that are at AUC. I've been involved in many, many of them. And I think this is where, when I make a decision, I know what I'm doing. I know what my strengths are and how to build on that. So that's basically the story of my life and where I am. And let me show you the story of my current life, which is strategic enrollment management. And I'm sure that many people here do not know what I'm doing exactly and what offices are there. So I have some of the leaders, the fantastic leaders that I work with, whether under my leadership or not. But it's really a very, very, I'm very honored to be working with this group. But let me show you what this is. This is the definition of strategic enrollment management: is a comprehensive process designed to help an institution achieve and maintain the optimum recruitment, retention, and graduation rates of students, where optimum is defined in the academic context of the institution. So it's not, a lot of people think that enrollment means that let's recruit people. No, it does not. It's not this way. We have Mahagindi here, who is the executive director of the Career Center, which is at the heart of strategic enrollment management. So we need to think about it as an integrative part. It's not like not a silo, and that's the core of the discussion. So the key new SEM directions include avoiding the silos culture. So it's not my term; I cannot plagiarize that. It's Henderson's term. Okay. Involving the whole institution in this SEM process and integrating planning strategies and institutional culture. So it's all about integration. It's about building a culture. It's not about theoretical thing. I don't believe that taking courses here and there, and that's it. If you take three courses that are completely unrelated to each other and you don't see the value of linking them together, I don't think this will work. You have to link them either through concepts or through your own personality and how you can have the overall breadth in your perception, in your perspective in life. So this is how I believe, and based on that belief, I'm working now in my office. We have, as I said, we have several offices. So these are the five offices that lie under SEM. The first one is the Office of Recruitment, Admissions, and Student Service Center, which is led by Ms. Randa Kamel. The Office of the Registrar, led by Ms. Rasha Mahmoud. The Office of Strategic Academic Services, which has three leaders up there. The three are here. We have Nirmin Hashim, we have Aya Kharbutli, we have May Rami, who are leading different areas. Nirmin is leading the area of business analysis and insights, working on processes, communication, banner support, and many other things. We have Aya, who's handling the area of retention management, issues related to statistics, issues related to student success in general. How to depict the students who have problems, how to solve the registration problems, how to improve advising, and so on. We have also May, who is handling projects such as life mentoring program that many of you have attended for. She's also handling issues related to the student's journey and how to map the journey and how to improve the quality of support students receive. So this is the office. We also have the International Programs Office, led by Ms. Dalia Taib, where we have interactions with partnerships with universities outside to offer our students international experiences. So we have exchange programs, partnerships. We try to get some to liaise the schools with the universities outside to offer joint programs, joint courses, blended courses, and the likes. And also we have the Career Center, led by Ms. Maha Gindi as well. So this is, of course, a well-established center. We all know about it. But the key for me is not just to have different offices, is the linkage between these offices. Is we have meetings regularly, and we try. The first thing that we did is that we met together. Each one is incredibly passionate, incredibly competent. But when we met together, this was very interesting. Just talking together, and they can witness that, allowed us to find collaborations, allowed internal ones, allowed us to find synergies, and allowed us to think about it from the perspective of the student rather than what each office is doing. So that was something educational for me, and it's really a pleasure to work as a team. This really makes a difference, and is going to be the core of my talk. So SEM at AUC, what's the mission statement that we have as a team? We aim to recruit a diverse group of future leaders and support their journey from enrollment to graduation. So the word journey is the key here. Through a student-centered approach, another key word, which is a word that Dean Switzer just mentioned, and it's at the heart of what we do, that maximizes their retention and success and effectively prepares them for career development and advancement. The words in red are the key words that we work on, and we want to build this culture working together to reach this objective. We have specific objectives, and we have specific initiatives to reach them. Some are short-term, some are longer-term. But this is what we want to do. Right. So the question for us is how to measure student success, the key term in this symposium. Is it by completion rate? How many successfully complete and get dismissed or fail in making it till the end, graduation? Is it by GPA? Not sure. Is it by employment afterwards? Maybe. But again, based on my story, I think there is the degree, but also there are the skills that you acquire. And one of the things that a lot of employers talk about, the attitude, a lot of people are criticizing the attitude of our students after graduation. We need to work on that. We need to look at the ultimate goal. We want our students to be successful. We want them to be impactful as well, right? We want them to be good citizens. So all these things are integral parts. We are not giving them a degree. We are not giving them just the technical knowledge. This is far too simple and too easy. And that's our role. And that's why this kind of discussion is really inspiring for me. Okay, let me ask a couple of intriguing questions to you. How many science theses were commercialized? Anybody knows of, the final projects, the thesis of the science here at AUC? You find a lot of displays, you find a car, you find something very interesting, and you go and take a picture next to it, right? And students get A's. So, and then they're thrown away. So how can we push this forward? Any question why this is not possible? I'm not saying that all of them are going to be commercialized, but at least many of them can. And if they are designed from the beginning to that level, it makes a difference. Why am I having a great idea, but this idea is not translated into reality? That's a big question, right? So coming from science, I know that, and it's a pity. So why? Because science students do this as a project. They finish the project, they get their degree, they are very happy that it happened. And then who is going to take leadership in turning it into something else? Do they know how to commercialize? Do they know the other aspects? Yes? Commercialized, what does it mean? Of course. No, I'm not saying that. I'm asking in general. But yes, the Venture Lab could play a role in that by turning these projects, maybe taking this as a target, and try to support it, to support them. How to do that, that's another story. But at least knowing that there is a lost opportunity somewhere, I'm not here providing with clear answers to that. Yes, this definitely is something in my mind, but maybe it's not the only one. Maybe we do not just need to think about it as what happens after the projects have been developed, and then let's commercialize them. What about thinking about commercializing them while the students are starting the project, right? So it could require planning. It's not just about finding a venue. It's as if we have students getting out of AUC, and then let's see how to fit them to the market. Why not understand what the market needs and see our gaps, and then accordingly improve or maybe prioritize what we should do in order to make them readier to success. This is the concept, and I think this is what I want to allude to. I'm not sure I don't have the answers to everything, but I'm trying to raise the questions. Let me give you another quick question. Let's not go science, let's go projects in general, research projects, academic projects, and so on. How many of these are shelved? Are they really nice? Do you think nice articles, nice pieces of papers, nice projects related to community-based learning, and then students graduate, and then what happens next? Okay, unless there is a champion here who makes this sustainable and repeated, and there are many here on campus, and it's individual efforts. So what happens? Why can't we think about it this way? How can we make an impact from this? Isn't this success? Okay, for me, lost opportunities are not really indicators of success. But that's something that we can think about. Okay, so let's think about who benefits from good education. We are offering something, we are calling it success, so who are the beneficiaries? So there are two groups. First of all, the society, the market. So they find solutions to complex problems. When we say, for example, we have a water problem, we have a behavioral problem, we have an educational problem. So who said that this should be solved by one group, right? If we find students with a certain degree, maybe they are capable of being part of solving the problem. But we want to solve societal problems, we want to solve market problems, we don't want to solve functional problems. Because yes, we may, but this will not have a significant impact. So talent needs to solve that. And the students themselves are beneficiaries. They need capabilities to solve such problems. And solving them does not mean that they must be only focusing on one degree. And by the way, AUC is very advanced. Other non-liberal arts universities do not offer this. We offer this, but we need to do more. And that's what my message, that we are at a good level. And I think that we need the last touch that can bring the great thing that we do into significant impact. So, and students need access to market opportunities. They need to see what's happening in real life, because they will realize that the issues are different and they are not this course. You know how many of us hear the students tell them what exactly the exam is going to be on, right? This is a very weird question for me. The exam is about that topic. If you understand it, you'll be able to manage it. Well, maybe you don't know, but I give open-ended exams. Open-ended exams. It's just everybody's, it's open book, open notes, open everything. Do what you want. Okay, solve the problem. So this is what we do. So they need to think. They need to think from a different integration. When I teach courses in marketing, I do not tell them this is marketing, but that's the other area. No, we have a case. We need to understand the other areas. And then we get deeper into the implementation of our area. That's fine. But if you don't link them to the other areas, you are not solving the business problem. Okay. So are we serving our beneficiaries efficiently, effectively? This is what we need to think about. What is missing? I would say integration. That's what's missing. And again, I'm not saying that we are far. I think that we are good. And I think if we focus on integration, we go to the next level of impact and perfection. Let me show you something from the market. Another statistic that really shocks me as somebody teaching in the School of Business, and that's worldwide, that's not only in the region or in Egypt. 90% of tech startups fail, and startups in general, about 90% fail, plus or minus. That's a statistic coming from WAMDA, which is the biggest platform in the region, right? So how come is that? How can we accept that? Why do we allow this to happen? This is a waste, right? Definitely, there are many reasons for the failure. Some of them may be the business environment, maybe the legal environment, and so on. But if we plan for it and you understand it, if you get the right support at the beginning, maybe you can avoid this and increase the number a little bit, right? Let me show you something, a piece of research. So I'm trying to raise different hats, the hat of the teacher, the hat of the researcher, and then the administrator. So bear with me on that. That's the last one on research. That I will show you a model that I developed on entrepreneurship, which is about to be published, hopefully. It was published in a non-academic journal, and it's going to be hopefully published in an academic journal soon. But that's the concept that we got to. I coach a lot of entrepreneurs. I've been coaching them for long. And some of them come to me and talk, and then when I talk to them, I get a feeling that they will not be able to carry the business. Impossible. They have passion for the product. But they do not have passion for the business. What does this mean? They are very technical. So one of them came and asked me a very interesting question. I was explaining how to do cash flow management and how to do valuation for the company and how to calculate profits and all these kinds of simple stuff. And I thought that this is going, he just wanted to know the idea so that he as an entrepreneur would be able to carry the business. And I was asked the weirdest question that really raised my eyebrows, which was, can you give me a reference or a textbook to read about your area? And I thought, well, entrepreneurship is about your business. Do you have time to do that? Do you want to read about marketing? You are not going to be the marketeer. You just need to know the idea. You need to know the concept. And then you need to apply that. Why do you want this? And I figured out that this is a faculty member in one of the national universities in science, fantastic one, doing great, but I give him the simple advice. What about you sell the company? What about you just do not carry out the leadership of the business? You do not want to manage, you don't want to operate, you don't want to have human resources under you. And the biggest smile I've seen in my life. Yes, as if a burden has taken out. Okay, so not everybody can be an entrepreneur because the entrepreneur has characteristics. Same thing, sometimes you get a brilliant student or brilliant graduate from Harvard. And this person is a fantastic manager, incredible eye to detail, perfection in everything. But does this carry the character of the entrepreneur who is a risk taker, business developer, network person? No, maybe it's an introvert or somebody who's like very, very focused on details. That's not an entrepreneur. So sometimes we do something very strange, that's not an AUC, but in general, we give support to somebody and say, give me a business plan. I have not seen an entrepreneur who can write a business plan, impossible. An entrepreneur can write a one-page business plan, but cannot write a 50-page business plan, and he or she is evaluated based on the quality of the business plan, not on the idea. And then I talked to a lot of venture capitalists, and they told me something very interesting. They told me that they select, and that's literature, they select the ventures to invest in based on the character of the entrepreneur, not the idea. People think about idea and calculate numbers that are based on assumptions anyway, so nothing can be verified. And they say that perseverance, character is what matters, because maybe this person, if they fail, they will come in again. I will invest in this because I'm investing in a company and in a person. I'm not investing in an idea. So that's something very interesting. So this brought me to this team model. I'm not going to bore you with the details of it. I'm just going to just take the words. Team here stands for T-E-A-M. And if you look here, you'll find that the tech skills or the ideas, we need that. We do not want a business person to carry the business. We want somebody very technical to come up with the technological idea and the R&D. This will be the R&D of the venture. But this person, very rarely can be the entrepreneur, will not be able to carry the business and lead it. He is the entrepreneur. The entrepreneur is the risk taker, is the somebody who can really go, very nice, a character that is more extrovert, goes and talks, grabs the opportunity, smart, who can understand everything, but is not interested in the depth of each one except the overall business. And then the managers who are the ones who are very operational, very detail-oriented, who can carry out the day-to-day activities, right? And then finally, the fourth one I thought of is the assisting functions, because if we have these three people in the company or the new startup, what about the assisting functions? What are the functions that are going to support this business at the beginning, financially, legally, and so on? If they don't have this, they will be carried out. So I thought about this as the team model, and if I would like to invest, I would invest in a successful venture that has the three together. Could be three people, could be two, cannot be one. Maybe it's one at the beginning, but the first step, if you are a technical person who can manage and you want to be an entrepreneur, you have to give up on two of them and become the entrepreneur, right? And get a partner who is more technical, or get a team who manages. If someone decides to say, I'm going to do everything, it's not gonna succeed. So that's a research model that you came up with after analyzing this issue. And again, the issue of integration, the issue of the roles, but these people together will carry something successful. It's not that one person trying to do it all or one person trying to focus on the area in hand. So, do we have success stories at AUC? Many, 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 many of them. So I'm going to show you one very simple, just a picture that I had from last year about teams. It's a competition at John Molson in Concordia University. I'm sure Dr. Amani here is smiling because she has been the lead in introducing this. So you see that these kinds of things, where they come from. And interestingly, it's about engineering commerce competition. And I've been blessed to meet with the teams. This is the third year this year. And our teams have done fantastic. Our teams have been competing very heavily. They have been in the top echelon of the teams up there. And interestingly, they required that the students have two students from engineering and two students from business. And it was, of course, it could have been more diverse as well, but they required it. That's the requirement, so we did it. And it was very interesting for me to coach four students coming from totally different backgrounds talking to each other. And if you think business are the same, no. If you take somebody who is concentrating in marketing, it's completely different than one concentrating in finance, different from somebody in economics. They do not have the same exact, or accounting, they don't have the same exact mentality. But coming engineering and business, the people are thinking differently. And the problem is a little bit complex, and each one needs to understand and value the depth of the other, but at the same time, they have to understand what the other one is doing. And the art of what I was trying to do, I was not their advisor. Their advisor was Dr. Naveen, who has done an incredible job and a lot of effort. I just met with them a couple of times, but the three teams over the 3 years. The main thing I was telling them, how to manage their time in order to solve it as a team. So it's not about the technicality now, it's not about rehearsing, it's about how to synergize your efforts to optimize the time utilized so that you come up with an integrated and solid solution. And they have done incredibly well. This year, the team came back this year and said that their score was like, yeah, they came second in their group, right, with a couple of points less than the other, and they were very praised. This team also came fifth. So I think we got fifth out of 16 teams or something like that, and we were very close to number one or number two. Very impressive. I'm very proud of our students. I think our students are fantastic. This is not the only competition. The School of Business, we sent about 25, 30 teams to international competitions, but only business. And they have done incredibly well. So I have to tell you, we are competitive internationally. If we give the right support and we let them think in an integrative manner rather than in a silo manner. So one of the things I had experienced myself in real life was my work at Procter & Gamble, where I worked in a multifunctional team. I didn't understand what this was. I was coming from engineering. I was joining finance because I love numbers. That was the only reason I had, okay? I love this. So the first time I understood that they are restructuring the company, this was back in the late 90s or early 2000s, and they said, we have to have one goal, multifunctional team from different areas, work together towards one goal, because what used to happen is that each one had a vested interest in a certain aspect, and I am a finance, I want profitability, I want my price to be high, I don't want to risk anything. Somebody in operation, I want accurate numbers, I want to be conservative. Somebody in marketing wants to get more revenues and market share and sales, they want to get their commission. When they work together as a team, the performance of the company completely changed. Just one goal, one object, one goal to reach, and one work to achieve. And therefore, the most important thing I want to send a message about is the interdisciplinary approach. It entails the use of integration of methods from more than one academic discipline, from multiple, the key term is integration, and the key word here is richer understanding of the issue under examination. So that's what I wanted to emphasize. It's not about just taking my role. It's about solving the problem. We are in an office. Students have problems. I want to solve the student problem. It's not, I was saying that this is not my responsibility. It doesn't work this way. So this mentality needs to change a little bit. So it requires interdisciplinary collaboration. So that's the challenge of the 21st century based on William Grassi. So breaking the silos is the objective. This is what we want to do, is bringing down boundaries and encouraging disciplines to learn from each other. We need to respect and understand each other's disciplines. We need to value that this plus this, one plus one plus one equals 10. This is what we need to do. So this is what I recommend as an optimal approach. We have the discipline in the education is the depth. We have the breadth, comes from the core curriculum, comes from the integration that we would like to do. And also the teamwork and the integration will be the rest. So depth, breadth. Without breadth, it's not well-rounded, thinking one way and not solving any problem. So where are we at AUC? We have a lot of great things. We have the Academy of Liberal Arts, which is something we are very proud of. We have core curriculum, 40 credits, which constitutes 25 to 33% of the curriculum for any major, something very, very valuable. I was saying that as engineering students long time ago. Why are we taking these courses? I graduated, and I thought, well, I have to take this course. Let's take it, khalas, okay? And then, after graduation, this is the main thing that really affected my my life and hopefully my successful story. And co-curricular activities, critical ones. So we want depth of knowledge plus well-rounded personalities. This is what I believe is there. What is missing? Integration. This is what we miss. We do not want to be in silos ourselves. We do not want to label this as this is a humanity course, this is a core course. Take this course and then let's focus on our core course. Take an easy core course so that we move on. I don't think this should be the way we are talking about it. So we need to educate faculty, we need to educate students that this is how it works. It's not teams different from each other. What are the challenges? It's a culture. A lot of things I think are challenging, but we need collaboration across departments and units. We need commitment. We need somebody who's committed to do that. It's an extra effort. Each one of us is overloaded. So who is going to carry this? Who's going to take leadership? I think ALA is taking a very nice start on that, at least bringing this discussion, pushing it. And actually, this is the natural leader for this, but needs support from the other areas. Needs accountability and ownership. If nobody is taking it, this is what I always mention in my area, and my team always hears this from me. We need a goal. We need somebody responsible, timeline, and we achieve this. We commit to it, and we achieve it. And then we need students' acceptance, because also students don't understand that. And we need to spend a lot of time and effort in order to make them believe in it. It's not in their DNA. It's not in our DNA. It has to be developed. And employers also don't understand that. So employers want something, but they need to understand that we are offering something like this, and they need to understand that if they want a degree, if they want somebody, if they want to hire somebody, I want somebody who is graduating from this area. I don't know why. Why are you saying that? I want somebody with certain skills. Maybe, yes, I cannot. I need an engineer to do something specific. But they need to be very flexible about it. I graduated from engineering. My first question to my first interviewer, I remember very well. I was very loose in the interview because I thought I was not going to be taken. Because I'm coming from a different degree. I didn't know. And they were telling me, no, we are looking for a person. We are looking for skills. We are not looking for a specific degree. And when I joined, I had people from political science in the IT department and people from economics in the marketing department, engineering in the finance, and so on. It was very interesting. So it's a culture, it's a new culture, and we need to embrace it. And it will take time, and it needs perseverance from our side to make this change. We should not give up easily, but we should recognize it's not going to come like this. It's not like an obvious thing, and we say it has to be believed. It's not just talked. So where to go from there? More interdisciplinary programs. This has to be led from top, in my opinion. ALA should be leading that, but it needs to be provoked and it needs to be pushed. Faculty have to link their disciplines together and refer to the other disciplines in a way or another. So co-teaching could be a very good option. A lot of things can happen. A lot of things are happening, by the way, but they are very minor and they are not well revealed. Focus on market problems. So if you're giving an exam, I think the exam should be focusing on something real. It's not focusing on my area. I cannot imagine that I give students a topic and I tell them, what is this topic? Well, where is the learning in that? So I think there must be a revolutionary change in how we examine students and how we challenge them to think rather than challenge them to know what the topic is. More interdisciplinary competitions like the engineering commerce. I think we need more. We can initiate ours. We say the one that will get the best idea that is well integrated will do it. And by the way, we have student clubs who do that. And you get impressed by the students how far they learn. Today, and I'm sure Dr. Nirmin is going to leave for that now, is one of my own former company, PNG, offering a competition. But 120 students are involved in it today. They are presenting in front of judges from the company solving a very complex case. And many of them do not have any idea about the topic, and they come and ask. And it was very, I spent a lot of time last week talking to a lot of teams, okay? And many of them do not understand the term, and they want to know, because they want to solve the problem. So when they think about solving a problem, it's completely different than doing an assignment, okay? And then educating and involving employers about that what we offer is skill, not just a degree. And then where to go from SEM perspective. I'm sorry I took a couple of minutes more, but I'm almost done. This is what we'll do in our area. So application on what we do here, a student-centered approach and culture, this is what we're gonna promote, and we'll do a lot of efforts to build that. And this is our commitment for the coming few years. Involvement of students and other stakeholders in planning. I'm not gonna plan in my silo, okay? So its implementation also should be done in an integrated manner. It should be an inclusive process. And inclusive is not just to get a buy-in. It's inclusive because, well, all the projects that we have done successfully involve students in the team, and their ideas and support was the core of the success. The life mentorship program, actually the students' input was unbelievable. They do the effort, they believe in it, they are excited, they excite the others, and it trickles down. This is how it changes. The integration of all the offices within SEM, this is what I'm doing. It's trying to work together. The projects do not have to be office by office. The collaboration with all offices on campus, so what this is what we will do. We are not going to work in our own offices only. It's the project, and then within the project, we form the team that will make it happen on the ground. And of course, we need accountability. We measure and monitor and deliver with an accountable manner. We will deliver this by that time to achieve this. Have we achieved it or not? This is what we want to do. So bottom line, the keys to success, three things: the depth, which is the expertise and knowledge, the breadth, which is the skills and personality, but also the integration, the synergies across the different learning areas. This is what we want to add to our package. We have it, but we can improve it. So as educators, we aim to help future leaders excel. We want them to solve problems in society. If we remember that and we take this as a start and we have a student-centered approach, we are going to break our silos. Thank you.